Let's talk about that. I mean, you know, the theory that that would have been some type of maybe perhaps inciting moment. Let's turn to Prop 8, which fortunately is still dead and dead for always. But the grounds upon which it was killed in terms of standing is somewhat controversial. But just give us a slight history of what took place in the Prop 8 fight.
Right. So there was legal gay marriage in California for a brief period. It was court ordered. Opponents put forward Proposition 8 in 2008. They won that by a very slim margin. It was actually the second most expensive election in 2008 outside of the presidency itself, which is stunning to think about. Decision, while it didn't invalidate the gay marriages that had already happened, it made marriages going forward illegal. It said you just can't perform these in California. So there were lawsuits that went forward. The controlling decision now actually is a decision made in 2010 by district court judge named Vaughn Walker. And he put an injunction against people in the state from enforcing Prop 8. He just said, you can't do this. This is unconstitutional. Very cleverly, his ruling cited Justice Kennedy on 15 separate occasions, which was clearly, awareness that this is going to head to the Supreme Court and that Kennedy would be a crucial vote there. It turns out that actually Kennedy voted on the other side in the Prop 8 case, that he thought that actually the defendants had standing. The standing issue is ultimately what was decided here, and that just basically kicked the decision back to the Ninth Circuit and asked them to dismiss it, which means the district court ruling is the controlling ruling on this. So there wasn't actually, from the Supreme Court, in this instance, a grand ruling about gay rights or equal protection. It just said that the defendants in this case didn't have standing. And that's because the state of California itself declined to defend its own law. This is very similar to what the Obama administration did with DOMA. They declined to defend it in the Windsor case. And so you had anti-gay advocates ask to be the defense in this case, to defend the law that California decided not to defend. And the court's ruling was that they just simply don't have standing to bring this in front of the courts.
Where is the consistency between the DOMA ruling and the Prop 8 ruling on the question of standing? I mean, what made those cases different? If the Obama administration is not defending the federal law, and the problem for standing in the context of the California law was that the state of California was not defending it, where's the consistency there?
In the defense of marriage case, the House Republicans actually also decided to defend it. This is John Boehner's decision, and there was some question about their standing there. So that was possibly a factor. I'm not exactly sure. I'm not a lawyer, honestly, right. And so the minutiae about standing in one case versus the other, I'm not totally up to speed on.
All right. Yeah, no problem. I mean, there are some people who, at least in the context of the Prop 8, and this is one of the reasons, Sotomayor was presumably on the wrong side of that case, was that people were somewhat concerned with the concept that individuals, citizens of a state, have no standing when a referendum is overturned. That brings up a host of other sort of legal questions, but the issue in this case was complicated by the fact that the very problem that these defendants had in terms of they couldn't prove that they were harmed by gay marriage was also sort of a good reason why was also sort of in some sort of backhanded way also spoke to the validity of outlawing gay marriage.
From the legal advocates I speak to, they actually think the sort of precedent set about on standing from this particular case is going to be somewhat limited, just because the defendants here, they just couldn't prove that they were actually hurt,
right,
by the making Prop 8 illegal.
Let's talk a little bit about what happens next. I mean, obviously, is this perceived in terms of this fight for marriage equality, was this perceived and is it perceived as essentially the critical mass? I mean, is it, in other words, are the efforts now sort of more, do the efforts, I don't want to say coast, but in terms of like the greatest hurdle, was DOMA that hurdle?
DOMA was a huge hurdle. I by no means is the battle over. Even just on the question of marriage alone, there are 30 plus states that have constitutional marriage bans. 37 states don't recognize same-sex marriage. So that is definitely not a fight that's over, and I don't think it's going to be over in the next year or two. It's going to be a quite a long struggle that's going to involve a lot of grassroots organizing as well as litigation. 29 states, Sam. In 29 states, you could be fired simply for being gay, because the Employment Non-Discrimination Act, what's called ENDA, hasn't passed Congress yet, despite President Obama saying he would want to sign that. So, in terms of anti-gay discrimination, this is a very significant step. It's a step that extends rights to millions of Americans, but it's by no means the end of the struggle. The struggle continues, as Melissa Harris Perry likes to say.
And in some ways, I guess the concept of marriage is going to help to eat away at that at the resistance to passing things like ENDA. I mean, maybe not so much in the short term, the nature of our politics now. But I mean, I'm curious just from a sort of a broad societal standpoint. I mean, was that point maybe reached just when the majority of the public had no problem with marriage equality?
Yeah, the shift in poll numbers has been just incredibly swift here. 5-6 years ago, the majority didn't support same-sex marriage. They didn't even support halfway measures like civil unions or domestic partnerships. A solid majority of Americans support same-sex marriage now. It's only moving in one direction. When you poll young people, I think that's where the change is most acute. Young Republicans support same-sex marriage. So, I think just in terms of a political dynamic, it's going to be interesting to see how the Republican Party deals with this. Very similar situation to immigration reform.
Right.
They're at risk of losing, perhaps permanently, a key demographic, not just gay people and not just Latinos, but young people of all races and sexual orientations care about these issues. And if they see the party fight tooth and nail to maintain discrimination, that is going to have, I think, some pretty serious repercussions.
Yeah, people should keep in mind that in 2004, gay marriage was basically a cudgel used by the Republicans as an electoral strategy, and that has completely flipped in many respects. Richard, I mean, what do you think accounts for this? I mean, because, sometimes I think that, like things like Ellen, frankly, like that sitcom, Will and Grace. I mean, I can't help but think. I mean, I look at, because this has really happened over the course of my adult life, and it's stunning.
Yeah, it is stunning. I definitely think popular culture and those sorts of things helped. I think something that underlies all this is the fact that same-sex marriage doesn't harm anybody. No one has been effectively able to show that their straight marriage has been harmed by two men or two women getting married in any state where it's legal. So, it is one of these rights that was opposed by vast majorities of Americans at one point, opposed quite vociferously and stridently. But I think once it became a reality, people realized that it actually does no harm to anybody. And you actually saw that in Iowa, which, has same-sex marriage, and that was court ordered, and there was a big, you know, kerfuffle about that. There were some judges on that court that were voted out in the next election, but now most Iowans accept it. A lot of them actually applaud it. They're very proud that their state is one of the states that recognize same-sex marriage, and even the sort of middle there realizes that it actually doesn't harm their lives in any extent. So, I think it's a kind of a no-brainer, and it just sort of takes a cognitive shift to realize that, and that's what happened in the last few years.
Yeah, it's been stunning, and it's really, it's been just incredibly moving to see, to hear the stories and to see the images of people who, have spent... Go ahead.
A lot of hard work went into it, I don't want to also discount that even as it is a kind of a no-brainer, a lot of gay people came out of the closet, they talked to their family, they, gave money, they raised money, they held rallies and pushed their legislatures and used their fundraising strategically. They threatened the Obama campaign. We're not going to support you unless you have our backs on this. So a lot of hard work also went into this.
Where do you think some of that energy, does that energy still continue to fight for things like ENDA and marriage in other states? Do you think that some of that energy, in other words, has there been, you've had a culture of activism and certainly there are still fights to be fought, but I wonder if there isn't a dynamic where some people take what they've learned through this fight and sort of the sense of social justice that they've learned in this fight and begin to branch out, or is it too soon?
Yeah, that's my hope. I mean, there's still tons of work to do on just securing rights for gays and lesbians, and there's lots of inequality also inside the gay and lesbian community. Gays and lesbians are more likely to be homeless. They actually make less money than their straight peers, despite the myth of gay wealth. So that, there's a lot of work to be done there. But I do think there is a sort of spark of social justice that this whole long movement has ignited. And I was at the Stonewall Inn yesterday, watching Edith Windsor talk to a huge crowd there. And one of the interesting things was that one of the speakers brought up the Voting Rights Act case.
Mm-hmm.
And the entire audience started booing. They were incredibly upset by that decision, and they were very upset that, on the day that they secured rights, the day before, minorities lost in many crucial ways the right to vote. You see that sense of injustice and the capacity to change that, and I think that is a great spark, and I do hope that this sort of energy momentum carries over to other campaigns. It's very interesting also to look at the states now that are going to pass voter ID laws. They've already passed voter ID laws. Those are the same states where there are constitutional bans against marriage. So those are the same states where you have incredibly restrictive abortion laws. Those are the same states where a Republican-dominated state legislature is pushing forward anti-union legislation. I think there is also a hope that all of these groups, feminists, gays, African-Americans, environmentalists, that they could come together in these states and create a real grassroots coalition to push back on this far-right agenda.
Yeah, I mean, it's fascinating to see the right sort of adopt this incredible bunker mentality when it comes to social change. I mean, I guess that's the very definition of it, but it just seems like it's becoming more pronounced to the extent that you can literally draw lines around it they're that much more isolated. Richard Kim, executive editor of Nation.com, thank you so much for your time today. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Sam.